Okay, good morning, friends. We are back on Fenny for the Soul for yet another interesting interview. This time we have a very respected guest, Claude Alvarez, noted environmentalist from Goa and secretary of the Goa Foundation. The Goa Foundation has been on the forefront of many an environmental battle against the state and central governments. Most famous for managing to stop the iron ore mining in Goa in 2012. The Goa Foundation today has taken up the legal route to help save Goa's protected forests from the central and state government's mega infrastructure plans and projects. Fortunately, thanks to Goa Foundation's timely intervention, a central empowered committee of the Supreme Court is set to visit Goa in the next 15 days to actually take stock of the infrastructure projects on the ground, and which will go a long way, I'm sure, in helping solve this to stop this plans of the government. So without much ado, let's kick off with the talking to Claude. Claude, welcome to Fenny for the Soul, and a lovely good morning to you in the Happy New Year.
Same to you.
Thank you, Claude, for giving us this time. So let me start, Claude, by saying, the first question really is, in your June 2020 petition to the Central Empowered Committee of the Supreme Court, you have clearly stated how these triple infrastructure projects of rail, road and power transmission lines are a complete contravention of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So, kindly explain to the lay audience, why this is so and how dangerous it is.
These three projects are all going through the Bhagwan Mahavir National Park and the Bhagwan Mahavir Wildlife Sanctuary. This is an area of 240 square kilometers, which has been notified from a very long time, from actually originally 1967 and thereafter 1978 and thereafter 1982. And they have remained in a very good state only because there has been no interference. It's true that there was a railway line going through it, but that railway line was installed somewhere in the year 1890. It's a single line and it has been there for a long time. It was there before the wildlife sanctuary came into existence. And the road also was there much before the Portuguese left. And in addition, there was also a transmission line which was installed, 110 kV transmission line, which was installed in 1967 first. So you have had these type of things, but they are all prior to it being notified as a wildlife sanctuary and a national park. So once an area is notified as a wildlife sanctuary or a national park, it's a recognition of the central government and the state government that this is an important part of the infrastructure of the state. See, we always think in terms of power lines and things like this as, railway tracks as infrastructure, but you've got to change your way of thinking. You've got to look at a wildlife sanctuary and national park itself as part of the green infrastructure of the state. It's an infrastructure because through that you achieve things like, protection of your biodiversity, your wildlife, your water supply, your climate change controls and so on. So it's part of infrastructure. Basically, it's a discussion between one type of infrastructure and another type of infrastructure. And all these infrastructures that have come up in the modern age now, power, high tension power line, 400 kV, or, the expansion of the road to accommodate more traffic and all these type of things. These are, not permanent infrastructures. They are, they keep evolving. 110 becomes 220, 220 becomes 400. A road which is 12 meters wants to become 24 meters. A single line wants to become a double line and all that. But unfortunately, they conflict with the Wildlife Act 1972, which had declared this infrastructure as important in its own right under constitutional directions. And therefore, it becomes really a decision of how do you decide which infrastructure is more important and which infrastructure you got to look for an alternative. So we, our argument and the argument of all the youngsters of Goa, the wildlife ecologists and the tourism trade and everybody who was in the, who has got a voice in the state of Goa has been saying, except the electricity department, all the others have been saying that don't damage the wildlife sanctuary. What we have said is that it's not only a question of you wanting to damage a wildlife sanctuary, you can't damage a wildlife sanctuary even if you want to, because the law doesn't allow it. The law, wildlife sanctuary, has got very stringent provision, section 29, section 35, which deal with wildlife sanctuary and national park respectively. And they say that, you know, unless the chief wildlife warden certifies that this development is in the interest of wildlife, that's a word used, in the interest of wildlife or in the interest of improvement of the habitat, you cannot allow a project to get inside. And if you've got, as a matter of fact, an existing road and the road is coming, you know, coming apart, then you don't repair the road, you give it up because it's now under wildlife sanctuary management. If you've got an electricity line which is old and dysfunctional, well, you remove that now because, you know, you have agreed that, you know, this is a sanctuary now, your line goes, you put it somewhere else. We don't care a damn over the cost. You can't damage the sanctuary because there was a discussion before a special expert committee called the Kanchan Chopra Committee in 2006 advising the Supreme Court on what would be the value of a forest which is destroyed for any development project. And they said that we can calculate the value for forest destroyed outside wildlife sanctuaries, but we cannot calculate the value of a forest destroyed in a wildlife sanctuary because that involves a different ball game because it's biodiversity, which cannot be quantified. And, you know, how do you quantify the value of endemic species, you know, hundreds of endemic species which are there, endangered species? How do you put an economic value to that? You can't put an economic value. So they said that we are not going to do any economic valuation of the damage done to a wildlife sanctuary through a development project because it cannot be done. Can be done for outside a wildlife sanctuary, but not within a wildlife sanctuary. So they understood exactly what, and the Supreme Court also respected it. But the Ministry of Environment, you know what the ministry does? They said that no, everything can be converted into money. So they said that, you know, outside a forest, suppose I'm just saying for the sake of argument, you decided the value of the forest is 1 lakh per acre. Well, in the wildlife, in the same 1 lakh in a wildlife sanctuary, you'll have to pay 10 times the price. The Kanchan Chopra committee said it's priceless. That means there is no price that you can put. But the ministry is a ministry of, you know, traders and businessmen. They said that no, everything can be given a price. So they said that, you know, we are putting a price on it 10 times the amount. Now, this is the way they deal with it. Now, we said, no, this is what, if you have done with it in the past, you may have approved some, you know, projects in wildlife sanctuaries in other parts of the country. But as far as Goa is concerned, we are going to hold you to a strict interpretation of the law. So we went to the Central Empowered Committee, which is an administrative committee set up by the Supreme Court. Supreme Court has passed an order in 2015, which says that, you know, any project approved by the National Board of Wildlife, if we can't examine every proposal, everyone comes before the Supreme Court because, you know, the Supreme Court only can grant approval for anything that's happening in wildlife. So they said that we'll ask the Central Empowered Committee, which was an existing committee. We said that, okay, you look at these minutes of the Standing Committee or of the Standing Committee of the National Board of Wildlife and tell us if there's anything wrong. Well, we don't have time. We've got to look at so many things. So they appointed the Central Empowered Committee to look at the minutes of this National Board of Wildlife and to examine whether any of those projects need to be brought to the attention of the Supreme Court as being in some sense dangerous for wildlife or not proper or whatever it is. And so under that framework of that order, which was passed in 2015, we filed a complaint before the Central Empowered Committee in June 2020 saying, look here, there's a project approved for doubling of railway track in December by the National Board of Wildlife. And then in December 2019, and in April 2020, in the space of just 3 hours by video conference, the ministry has approved some 30 projects in which they have also pushed in this project of the electricity line, 400 kV line through the wildlife sanctuary, and also approved the expansion of the highway from 12 meters to 24 meters. So we said that, look at these projects. The Central Empowered Committee doesn't even require us to file a complaint. They have got the power to do so on their own. But on the other hand, you know, sometimes it's also important for citizens to tell the committee, look, you know, there are these meetings that have taken place. We have a problem here. Please look at this. And the Central Empowerment Committee has got the power to say, yes, maybe we didn't look at it because we didn't have that type of information. Now this NGO has provided this information. Let us look at it from what the NGO is saying. Maybe these apprehensions are, you know, unnecessary. Maybe the authorities have looked after it very carefully. Maybe we find that what the NGO is saying has got substance. So he said that we will look at this case. So they have already had a hearing. During the hearing, they have expressed quite some disturbance at the project of the railway doubling, also of the national highway. They said that, you know, on the Karnataka side of the highway, you are going to remain to 12 meters because the National Highway Authority of India said that we will not go beyond 12 meters because that's also tiger sanctuary and so on. On the Goa side, the PWD of Goa, which is the same project, National Highway Authority project, they say that, no, we want 24 meters. So we said no. And the Central Empire Committee also was very, very skeptical. They said the Karnataka side is 12 meters. How can you make it 24 meters? You will have traffic jam. You will have bottlenecks. All the traffic will pile up at the border because, you know, from 24 meters, they're going to go into 12 meters. That will create a big problem for the sanctuary. It'll increase the pollution load, idling, obstruction to the movement of traffic, of the wildlife across. And no, they said that, you know, Goa government said, but, you know, at some stage, the Karnataka people will increase it from 12 to 21. They said, at that time, you come to us. Right now, we don't think that's a sound idea. So they had very difficulty with the national highway thing. They had a great difficulty with the railway. They said that you yourself are saying that a railway project is it's in very difficult terrain. So why don't you take the railway somewhere else? Why are you insisting? You are saying it's very difficult. It's a difficult gradient. You got to change the alignment. You got to do this. You got to remove this amount of mud, more than 10 lakh cubic meters of mud in a wildlife sanctuary to change, to disturb and all that. How is it possible? So they said, you know, it's better that you think seriously of doing something. You know, don't think about this railway. It may not even be necessary because at one stage you said that you planned this railway in 2010 when there was good business for Bellary ore to be exported to China. But today there's no ore going from Bellary. Everything has been stopped. Ore from export from Karnataka has stopped. And all the economics are gone. Then your coal, your chief minister has said that he's going to bring down the coal handling by 50%. So if all this is the case, why are you putting a separate line? There's no need. You continue with the same old line and you make the best of it because we are dealing with the wildlife sanctuary. So they have raised some queries and they said there is a serious enough, we are going to come to Goa. So they're going to come to Goa. I don't want to prejudge any issue. It is all open right now. These are preliminary findings and, you know, observations which they have made. They may change their view, whatever it is. I mean, we are before a committee of the Supreme Court. We said that we will discuss everything with them. We will present our evidence. They were very curious. They said, is this, we said that this is a proposed tiger reserve. So they said, we didn't know anything about this. So I said, no, it's a tiger reserve. It's been notified by the tiger authority that, you know, to the Goa government that you have got to declare this as a tiger reserve. So not been taken into consideration by the state wildlife board. So all these have to be considered. So they said, when we come to Goa, we'll spend 2 to 3 days there. We will look at everything. We'll ask for all the documents. We will, you know, and then we will come to a discussion because we will have to inform the Supreme Court whether these projects should go ahead or not. And if we agree that it should go ahead, then the NGO will get a chance to also represent to the Supreme Court that why the CEC is wrong. But if the CEC says, you know, that the NGO is correct, then of course the Supreme Court would consider that. But the Supreme Court would then also have to listen to the Goa government to find out whether what they have, you know, made out a case. So it will take some time.
Thank you, Claude, for this very comprehensive explanation. Thank you very much. Claude, I'm coming to this. You briefly touched upon it. In a very hasty manner, the Goa government got a nod from the Goa State Wildlife Board, you know, in a meeting in December. And then the Ministry of Environment and Forest got the National Wildlife Board to pass the three infrastructure projects in a video conference in April, 7th of April, 2020. I want you to comment on this, this hasty, mysterious ways of the, these two boards of the government. And there's no way to approach such serious, projects.
Yeah, no, what you're saying is correct. You are going to damage a wildlife sanctuary with these three large projects. Careful consideration has to be done. Now, if you look at the record, there was members, it had come before the Goa State Board for discussion, and the members of the Goa State Board had objected, the older board. So what these guys do is they reconstitute the board in May or June 2019, and they remove all the dissenting members and they put new members on it. And they actually write to the, to the authorities who are in favor of these projects. They write to them saying that, look, we have some problem with the board members. We are reconstituting the board. And once the board is reconstituted, we will call a meeting of the board and approve the project. This is the language that they are using. And in December, when they take the meeting, there are new members of the board. There are six new members of the board. At the meeting, they present them an EIA in the morning. While the meeting is just going to start, they say, here is the EIA for the project. And while these fellows are discussing it and raising some reservations about whether, we should have some, better studies done or whatever it is, the meeting gets over. It is held in the chief minister's residence and is soon declared over. Before they know it, the minutes are written up. The minutes are not approved. The minutes have to be approved by the state board at the next meeting. Before it is even approved, these fellows have sent the minutes to Delhi, because they have proposed to have a meeting in Delhi on the 7th of April, that is the national board. So they want to have these minutes safely sent there. So it's all very well planned in advance. And then when the minutes are actually disclosed, the six members of the board said, look here, we have never been party to any decision to approve these projects. The EIA was given to us in the morning. How can we read it and approve it while a meeting is going on? It's not possible. So they wrote a letter to the Forest Department in December saying that, look here, don't treat this as, because we have our reservations and we think that this decision should be properly discussed. But the Forest Department ignores the letter and sends the proposal to Delhi. Delhi conveniently puts it before the Board of Wildlife, and the board approves it in this video session. I mean, one of the members of the National Wildlife Board who's on the committee, he says, what can you discuss in a video conference, 30 projects, and each, if you take 30 projects into 3 hours, what do you get per project? You don't get any time at all to even, make any observations, object or do anything. They're all taken as approved, and everything is approved. And the minister is so proud, Mr. Javadekar, he's so proud that he has approved these 30 projects in wildlife sanctuaries, including the projects in Goa, in the space of 3 hours by video conference. He gives a bombastic tweet on his, on his Twitter feed saying that, we have done such a great thing today in this country under Mr. Modi, that we have, approved 30 projects in just 3 hours. And this is the way we are doing, speed of business. To allow, to support the interests of infrastructure development and this, that even if we destroy this whole country, we are there to do it because our intention is to promote business and we don't care a damn for wildlife, we don't care a damn for forest, we don't care a damn for people. Our interest is to promote the interests of the corporates and to ensure that they have power and roads to transport their goods and their coal and all these sort of things. So we are not going to book any opposition. We are right now in the position of power. We are going to approve everything. There is no question that we are going to reject any proposal. But these guys are already, old enough to go into their grave. But they are deciding, the fate of the next generation and the coming generation. They have got their own children, but their own children they are not bothered about. They are only bothered about their friends and about making more money, and about making business opportunities from every possible corner. And therefore, they are in this framework of mind. So everything is now just a formality. And that's how they have approved these projects. There's no defense. As a matter of fact, the EIA for the railway project, they manipulated that also. They went to a member of the standing committee, who is a member of the standing committee of national board, and they went to him and got the EIA done through him. Then the EIA, the same EIA, is produced at the meeting, and that member is sitting in the meeting. A pure conflict of interest, but they have taken care of him. So obviously the proposal is passed, and the other members of the committee will say, how can we object? Because the member who has prepared the EIA is also part of our pay. So obviously it is prepared very well, because it's prepared by one of our own members. And therefore, we have to accept it. We cannot challenge something done by one of our colleagues, after all. Arey Baba, but at least there must be some decency, some propriety. You may say that, this decision, at least the member should not be sitting here. Nothing is in this we have seen in the decisions of this government, they don't follow any norms of any decency, of any honesty, of any science, of any reason, of any logic. And forget about environmental consideration. That is completely out of the window. But that's how these projects have been approved. And that is why the whole of Goa is in a protest and in a rage. And that rage is not going to abate only because you have got the police power behind you and you have got all sorts of obnoxious people with guns and all behind you. The people of Goa have decided that whatever means possible, they will go move the courts, they will move the CEC, they will move the streets, they will move the authorities, they will move everybody, but they will not allow their biggest and oldest wildlife sanctuary to be dismembered and destroyed like this.
Absolutely. It's really, really shameful the manner in which those decisions have been taken. Talking of EIAs, Claude, there are three infrastructure projects and there is no cumulative EIA. This is something that environmentalists across the country have critiqued and criticized, and you also in your arguments has pointed this out. So can you tell us how it's completely wrong not to have a cumulative scientific EIA?
See, first of all, the problem of EIAs is this, that they manipulate even that. For example, they have already taken a decision that for a linear project, that is, electricity transmission line, you don't require an EIA. But if you are going to do, if you are going to divert more than certain area in a wildlife sanctuary by a linear project like an electricity line, I don't know what the area is, maybe 50 hectare or whatever it is, then you have got to do a biodiversity study. Biodiversity management plan, et cetera, et cetera. You got to do it. But it's not a legal requirement if you are below that area. So they passed that out. Then the highway. The highway is a 157 kilometer highway from Belgaum, Belgavi to Panji. Now, if you are below 100 kilometers, you don't require an EIA to be done. This is, again, these are the ways they manipulate the rules. So the rules say that you don't require below 100 kilometers. Now, why 100? Why? Because they have got that. It's got its own history. I don't want to go into it because it's too much of time in this particular case. So what they do, they divide the project into two projects. They tell the Karnataka government, you deal with your part of the project, which is probably some, 80 kilometers or so. And let the Goa government deal with their project under the PWD Goa. So their both projects independently become less than 100 kilometers. So you bypass that requirement of doing the EIA there. Though you're going through a sanctuary, though you're going through a tiger reserve and all that, but you safely remove it. And the railway, you have already said under the EIA notification, railways are not required. You require for airports. You require for nuclear reactors, you require for everything in this country, but for railways, for some reason, they say there is no need for an EIA. So you are having three projects through a wildlife sanctuary. One EIA is manufactured by the person who's sitting on the committee, that is the railway EIA. The Karnataka one, you say you are not required because though it's one project, the project is approved as one project of 157. You divide it to in order to say that it's below 100. And the third project, you said, I don't require biodiversity study because I'm below that particular area. So you are doing a project through the oldest wildlife sanctuary and national park of Goa. And you say, you don't require individually, proper environment impact assessments done. So this is their position in respect of individual environmental impact assessment. You forget, it has not even gone into their head that, hey, Baba, you are putting three projects in one wildlife sanctuary. What does this mean for the fragmentation of the sanctuary? Because the sanctuary is a wildlife habitat.
Yeah.
It is the right of animals to move from one part of the habitat to another part of the habitat. And from Mole Wildlife, Bhagwan Mahavir National Park and the sanctuary is part of four wildlife sanctuaries, which is a corridor, animal corridor.
True.
Which is also a tiger, proposed tiger reserve. Now, you are going to fragment this wildlife sanctuary and national park in three places in such a serious way, and you don't have any environment impact assessment done of all what will be the cumulative impact of these three projects on the sanctuary. You are in effect dividing it into three parts.
True.
Now, earlier there was a railway track and there was a road, but the animals have become accustomed to it. They're used to it. These roads reduce the speed of these because they are narrow roads. They're 12 meter roads, but they are two lanes, so traffic can move. But those roads cannot absorb coal trucks of 20 tons and 40 tons, which you want to move once you want to take the coal from Vasco to Karnataka. So you've got to make it into a 24-meter highway for the road, not because of the animal for wildlife. Wildlife is not creating any problem for you. These roads, the width of the roads is creating a problem for you because you want to move heavier traffic for wildlife. Sorry. We say that this cannot be done. You take the coal through other areas. There are at least four or five other roads going through from here to Belgaum, through Tillery, through Surla, through you take it through all those places. You can't do this here. It is a wildlife sanctuary. So these are engineers. Engineers in this country for the last 60 years have been brought up on a diet of, we are engineers, we don't care a damn for plants. We don't understand plants. We don't understand forests. We don't understand wildlife. We are only as engineers. Our duty is to cater for human beings. Arre bapre, but you are going through a wildlife sanctuary. The wildlife sanctuary has been set up because the government said that this area is sacrosanct for animals. And you got to justify in terms of whether it will improve the life of the animals. Well, how can you justify in terms of whether it's going to be useful for human beings? That's a different yardstick.
True.
You can't justify it. You get out from this area. You go somewhere else. So there is no chance. Even today, yesterday we have discussed with the Tanmar people about these issues. They said, see, you don't compare our project with the other two projects. Our project is a high transmission line. It is above the canopy. We are not going to cut down many trees. We are put in a proposal 4,500, but we are only going to cut the trees where the four towers are going to come up. We have reduced it to only four towers, and ours is below, above the canopy, so there's no impact on the wildlife. We are not going to do anything. All that chapatras they came. They said, you please don't mix us up with the other two projects. So they themselves are conceding that the other two projects are damaging because they said, don't mix us up. We are doing least damage. We have got no comment to make on the other. Baba, but you can't have that attitude. You have got to say, three projects are going to be constructed in a Mole Wildlife Sanctuary. Then let us sit together and see what is the cumulative impact that we are going to do. You can't say, I'm going to do, I have not that much impact as the other two. And the other two fellows say, no, we are national projects. We are going to go through it, whether we like it or not. You take your line somewhere else, but we are going to put the railway. So this is the attitude. They're all government. They're all government, part of the same government, but this is their attitude. And they said, we are not supposed to talk to each other also while doing these three projects, because they are in three different portions of the wildlife sanctuary and they are being done by three different authorities. So we don't have to look at each other's faces. We will do what we want in our own terrain. Now, if this is the level of the engineers you have got in the National Highway Authority of India, in the Railway Board, in the electricity sector, then God, have to look after this situation. And we are totally lost if this is the quality of the today. if you have, want to be a, rated as a good engineer, you have to be an engineer who can design a project without destroying nature, without destroying the trees, without destroying the forests, without destroying the habitats of wildlife. Only then I, Claude Alvarez, will consider you to be a good engineer. True. Otherwise, I will say that whether you are trained in IIT or in, it doesn't make any difference, because there's no difference between you IIT and one fellow trained in some engineering institute in Trichy or wherever it is, where he paid some 20 lakhs and purchased a degree. You have paid some little bit less and you have earned your degree, but there's no difference because you are all belonging to the past age, Purana Zamana. You are don't understand climate change. You don't understand anything because you have one tunnel vision. You have got engineering, engineering, engineering. And you don't realize that today we cannot destroy the forests and we cannot destroy our wildlife sanctuaries because, as I said, they are important part of our infrastructure. And unless you engineer sees this as infrastructure, only then you will say, how do I then put my infrastructure to support this infrastructure which is there so that both benefit? Absolutely. Animals benefit and I benefit.
Absolutely.
You cannot do that. People like Goa Foundation and all the youngsters in the state of Goa will oppose you because they will say that you are not fit to do any engineering in the state of Goa.
Absolutely, Claude. Very, very well put. You know, very well put. Thank you. Claude, talking of animals and flora and fauna, you know, as you know best, both these Bhagwan Mahavir and Mole Wildlife Sanctuaries are part of this 2,200 square kilometers of tiger habitat, you know, and something like one of the richest tiger habitats in India after Sundarbans. And now, and also they are home to hundreds of endemic, species of flora and fauna. I mean, we cannot afford to lose any of this. So, you know, as an environmentalist, would you like to comment on this, you know, on the severity of the topic? You know, how the tigers are so important to our forests and wildlife.
See, tigers are what are known as the apex species. If there is a tiger population in your area, it means the rest of the wildlife is functioning very well. Just like if you have, for example, a king cobra surviving in your area, it means all the other snakes are there because the feed of the king cobra is the other snakes. So there is, nature has got this cycle, this chain of being. Like from the fish in the oceans, it begins with the plankton, microplankton, and then it ends up with the whales, but they're all interconnected.
True.
So you remove some element of the chain, the whole system gets disturbed.
Absolutely.
So, and similarly, tigers, original ambit of tigers, I was looking at many of the old records, the original tiger population of the country, India, they, the same tigers, had a corridor which actually encircled the entire subcontinent. That means they moved from Western India, Northern India to East Coast, came down Western Ghats, that was the terrain to which the tigers moved in the time when there were few people around. They have managed to trace, this is tiger territory. The country is tiger territory. Now, unfortunately, because we didn't realize this and because of the population growth and so on, we have taken over, we have become what is known as a parasitic species. Just like in the forest, you have lantana, which has taken over. Similarly, on the planet or on the subcontinent, human beings have become the parasites. Because they have got the brain power and all, limited brain power, but because they have got this brain power, they feel that the parasite has now become the main thing. We have become the main species, but actually we are a parasitic species now because we are preying on everything else. And by preying on everything else, we are destroying also everything else because we are leading to extinction of species. And all the people, many species could have lost, you know, by natural evolution, but natural selection, but we have actively involved in destroying habitats. And so we are destroying species which are dependent on those habitats. So we have reduced the tiger populations to certain areas, like Sundarban is the biggest tiger area, but after that is the Western Ghats, the biggest tiger area. And part of the terrain of the tigers you know, the Bhimgarh, the Kali Tiger Reserve, and now recognized by the National Tiger Conservation Authority, which is the apex body for tiger conservation in India. They said the Goa 5-4 wildlife sanctuaries now have to become part of the tiger reserve, because then the tiger is free to move all along. Now it is condemnable and it's a disgrace that the Forest Department of Goa refused to admit that the tigers moved in the forests of Goa all these years. And they set back the tiger conservation program only for one reason, because once tiger conservation comes into the state, mining goes for a toss.
Correct.
Because the you know, the buffer zone for tigers is much larger, and therefore there's nothing much that you can do. But fortunately, the Tiger Conservation Authority does not have miners on their panel, and they look at tigers because they're under a duty to ensure that tigers are conserved in this province, their population increases. Because that is a national objective. Mining may be a national objective, you know, in terms of providing steel, but you can provide it for many areas. You don't have to go to an area which is close to a tiger reserve. You can go to other areas. But tiger is a national priority. It's a prime minister's priority area. That you cannot fool around with tigers. And once the National Tiger Conservation Authority issues a directive to a state government that you got to set up a tiger reserve, there is no choice. You have to set it up. But a state government has done very good work towards setting up the tiger authority after it was nudged into operation and after the killing of the 4 tigers in January 2020. Now they have been, you know, but the mining lobby has insisted, you know, brought in a lot of pressure so that they have taken it up to a point, but beyond that, they are not moving. So we have gone to the High Court. We have filed a petition in the High Court. That issue is coming up in January. And we have told the High Court that, look, this is whatever excuses they are coming up with is not at all acceptable. Right now, tiger conservation requires it. Where there are tigers, you are duty bound to set up a tiger reserve, because tigers are not small change.
True.
They are not small change. They are not like some other animals.
Yeah.
You, once the presence of a tiger documented, you have killed them, the carcasses are there, you have also got photo evidence that they are tigers, that the automatic conclusion is that you got to set up a tiger reserve.
Absolutely.
So the date is set, you got to set up a tiger reserve. Once a tiger reserve comes, automatically 560 square kilometers of the 720 square kilometers will become tiger reserve.
Okay.
They will be free to loaf. They can go to, you know, the Bhimgarh, they can go into the Kali tiger reserve. So it will become a huge tiger reserve, which will be kept, you know, sacrosanct. And all that we are saying is, you may do whatever infrastructure, you spend some more money. You may want to take your line a little bit detour. You do that. We don't care a damn. But you will not be allowed to cross this area because you are going to disturb the tigers. And the same thing happened on the Karnataka side. Karnataka forest officials have said, nothing doing. Your high tension line is going to disturb the forest. Your railway is going to disturb the forest. Your highway, we are not going to give you permission beyond 12 meters. But they have taken a better point of view for doing their duty. It's a duty of a forest officer to protect the forest and to protect the wildlife. It is not the duty of a forest officer to protect transmission lines and to protect highways and to protect, that is there is a separate department. But if you are not doing that job, and if you are allowing people to come and destroy, then you are not fit to be in the forest department. You are not fit. You better you go and join some other department, but don't remain in the forest department, because that is the wrong place for you. That is our message to the Goa Forest Department. And it is very unfortunate. They are very outstanding, good officers in Goa Forest Department. We have worked very well with them. But unfortunately now, 2 or 3 of the present people who are there in charge are really not fit to be here, and they should go. They should go, because as long as they are there, they will only create problems for the relationships of people in Goa with their forests and with their wildlife.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well said, Claude. Claude, finally, the good news is that Goa, the people of Goa, the young and the old, have, you know, risen together to fight this, challenge. So in your opinion, are you hopeful that this combination of people's resistance on the ground and the legal initiatives taken by Goa Foundation will, hopefully win the day for Goa and its people?
See, what happens in the courts, I cannot decide.
True.
And I cannot say will go in my favor, because I have gone to the court, I have gone to the CEC. A CEC is a fact-finding body. The court will go into the legal issues, and ultimately it will go to Supreme Court. And these courts will decide. I have a great faith in the courts, and I've been in the courts for 35 years. I filed over 300 petitions in the High Courts.
True.
So they all know the Goa Foundation. They know that we don't come with frivolous charges, that we have got serious sustained interest in the environment. We are not two-year wonders or five-year wonders. We have been here for 35 years, from 1986. So nobody can there. We are older than many judges of the High Court, many judges of the Supreme Court, and so on. So we are very serious people. We don't care. We are committed to this. We are also committed to the country. We are committed to development. We are committed to good engineers. We are committed to people who will do development for people, but without destroying the environment. This is our policy.
True.
We are not willing to budge. We are not willing to do balancing and say that, okay, we will allow destruction here in order to allow economy to flourish. That we are not accepting, because that is already done by the law.
True.
The law has decided balancing long time back. We don't want judges to do it. The law says in the wildlife sanctuary, you can't do this. You don't do it.
Right.
You don't say we will balance. You are an interested party. You want to put a project inside. How you are going to balance properly? Yeah. You are going to balance in your favor. Your data is going to be manipulated in your favor. The authorities are going to be manipulated in your favor. How do you do a balance? So we don't want any balancing. We are going to all these bodies. We are saying that this is the law. You please enforce the law. And we will fight it out there. What happens there? It is my duty to tell you and your listeners that we don't come to these decisions in advance. These are our concerns. We put it before them. They will decide. Now, what happens on the street is a totally different action. We are not part of the action on the streets, because once we go to the High Court, we are in that sense duty bound to respect the jurisdiction of the High Court. And therefore, we cannot go out on the streets and make noise there, because then we are exercising two fora. We cannot have 1 foot here and 1 foot there. So we don't interfere with street agitation.
Yeah.
It is not that we don't support them. We are in sympathy with them. Sometimes street agitation is far more successful than a court, going to the court. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows that this is a democratic country. You can use 50 options to gain your point of view, including changing the government. We have gone to court. We may have gone here. But we can also conceive of changing the government. So the government changes, we can say, sorry, we are not giving you permission anymore. Then we don't need to go to the court. We don't need to go to CEC. We don't need to go on the street, because then we are running the government. We say, sorry, we are not accepting these two projects. And that decision will come in 2022, when we have the election in 2022. At that time, we will decide whether to, because these projects are not going to be constructed in just 1 or 2 years or whatever it is. They will take some time. Before the damage is done, maybe there will be a new government which will decide that we, in the interest of at least mental peace in Goa and in the interest of tourism and so on, these projects are not required. And therefore, we are deciding to scrap them. Okay, whatever it is, we are deciding to scrap. It's also possible. That is also an option. As I said, there are lots of options. In a democratic country, there are hundreds of options. In a non-democratic country like China and all, they come with a gun. In the USA also, they send a National Guard. In some other place, there's a dictatorship, they will say, put you in the jail. But in Goa and in India, we have several options. We are a democratic country, and we have got a constitution to protect us. Government may not protect us, but the constitution will protect us.
True.
And as far as the constitution is there, the Supreme Court will protect us. That is our faith. And that is how we operate. And that we say, as long as we continue like this, and we do these type of actions, peaceful actions, one day the government is bound to recognize that the voice of the people has to decide.
True.
It is the people who decide how the resources of the state should be handled. It should be the people of the state who will decide whether the wildlife should be protected, whether the tiger is welcome, part of our ecology, and we will look after the tiger. It is the people who will decide this. And I'm very happy that in these present agitations against these three projects, the young people have taken charge. I have gone through many of these protestations, and I find that the young people are bringing a new language to the language of protest, They are doing it through artwork, they are doing it through song, they are doing it through social media. They have got the Save Mole Instagram page, they've got My Mole Instagram page, and they are doing a wonderful job with people like us, you know, who are more now, of course, we go for walking and all that sort of thing, but they are more mobile, they are better with their you know, cell phones.
Tech savvy. Takes
me 10 minutes to do what somebody can do in half a second, you know, or any of the.
True.
So we are very happy that they have come out that, and in the process, very remarkable thing is happening. They are getting involved in the decision making. You see, these decisions are taken by people without consulting the people of Goa. Decision to put high tension line taken decision by in Delhi by chief, by the Central Electricity Authority without consulting Goa. They say that we are the masters of the grid and we will decide that Goa needs a 400 kV line additional to what they have. So we are going to sanction it. Now, after that, what happens? Whether the people of Goa are to be consulted or they said, no, we don't require consultation. We can decide where to put the grid. We can empower ourselves under the Telegraph Act and we can walk into anybody's property and put the grid and so on. And we can do whatever we wish. So we said, okay, we will deal with that. When the time comes, we will come, we know how to deal with it. But I'm saying that the people are asking these questions, saying that, why did you take this decision without? There, in many of the meetings of the Central Electricity Authority, the member from Goa, from the Goa Electricity Department is marked absent. He did not even go and attend the meetings.
Yeah.
So you decide a line. Then the National Highway Authority of India says, we're going to make this into Panji to into 157 kilometers into 24 meter, you know, highway. They don't ask anybody. They say that we are a national project. We have to connect all the country, the national highway, etc. So again, the people are saying, we would like to know, in our small Goa, if you only reduce it to high tension lines and national highways and railway tracks and, you know, all sorts of other things, where is Goa? Goa has disappeared in this mass of concrete.
True.
Our peace of mind is gone. Even now, it is 1 week of Christmas. No Goan has come on the road because they know that if you come on the road, you're stuck for 3 hours, 4 hours. There are people like mad who have come from 4 or 5 lakh people have turned up here. They are running around trying to find some moment of gratification, some dance somewhere, some liquor somewhere. They have got this idea that in Goa for 1 week, you can do mayhem. You can drink tons of booze. You can accost women on the street. You can do. You don't need to go into a hotel. You come in a SUV, keep all your mal inside. You go and eat. You use sulabs, and you. Nobody knows what type of place you are creating, where the original inhabitants don't have a place. Their culture doesn't have a place. Their employment doesn't have a place. Nothing is considered sacrosanct. What type of planning is this? What type of development is this?
True.
That is now being asked by these youngsters.
Absolutely.
They are saying that you are promising to give us a world after you are gone. What type of garbage dump are you handing over to us?
Absolutely.
What type of a desert are you handing over to us? Don't you think you've got to think about these things? And I think that that message of these youngsters, particularly to art and music and so on, is remarkable. And if people can plug into it, it will have a great impact on the way people look at these issues in Goa. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Claude. Thank you for, you know, spending this time and giving us such wonderful inputs with your, you know, scholarship. So, Deo Bore Koro, Moga Sundi.
Deo Bore Koro. Moga Sundi.
Moga Sundi.